بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا يوافي نعمه يكافي مزيدا. يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك. سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك، أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك فلك الحمد حتى ترضى، ولك الحمد إذا رضيت، ولك الحمد بعد الرضا. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصلِّ وسلِّم على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصلِّ وسلِّم على سيدنا محمد في كل وقت وحين، وصلِّ وسلِّم على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين، وصلِّ وسلِّم على سيدنا محمد حتى تلث الأرض ومن عليها، أنت خير وارثين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله. There are those who have been gifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bear the secrets of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama. From amongst them, there was a great companion whose name was Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Karramallahu wajhahu. From amongst them is the great companion who is known as the bearer of the prophetic secret, Sayyidina Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. Sayyidina Hudhayfa, he said that he used to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the nature of evil. He said, كَانَ النَّاسِ يَسَلُوا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنِ الْخَيْرِ. That people used to ask the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about good. وَكُنْتُ أَسْأَلُهُ عَنِ الشَّرِّ. But I used to ask him about evil. مَخَافَةً أَنْ يُدْرِكَنِي. Out of fear that this evil would encompass me and envelop me. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam begins to describe to Sayyidina Hudhayfa radiallahu ta'ala anhu the nature of the usur, the nature of the various epochs, ages that will confront man from his time onwards sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first epoch that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first age was the age of unadulterated goodness. And in that age of unadulterated goodness came forth people of unadulterated beauty and goodness, the Sahaba al-Kiram, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thereafter, the age is followed by shar, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, evil. And thereafter, it's followed by good, walakin fihi dakhan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, but therein, that good will be tainted, there will be a taint, a stain upon that good. Where of those who approach the age of good that is stained, tainted, the winds of prophecy of the way of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are now being stirred. And those winds, the nafahat, as we heard our teacher Sheikh Yahya refer to, those winds are going to engulf the nafahat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're going to engulf, they're going to envelop certain members from the community of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by the community of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I mean the community in the broader sense, not necessarily Ahlul Islam. What we took from our teacher that there are those who are going to give victory to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam towards the end of the day and a half. The 1500 years that the Prophet spoke about, the ummah of a day and a half, that there are those who are going to give victory to the way of the Prophet وسلم, and at this point in time, they're in the midst of kufr, in the midst of absolute disbelief. And many are called, but very few are chosen. And it's for those who desire to be of those who embrace the nafahat, the winds that are stirred by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this age, to be of those of deep reflection of those who were situated in the great age of unadulterated good and beauty. We see a tradition on behalf of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, khadim rasulillah, khadim rasulillah, khadim rasulillah, the servant of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Would that those words resonate inside of our hearts until they are anchored and engraved on the depths of our souls. The Khadim Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, he spoke about some of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how they were of those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aligned their souls with the supreme soul of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Because the discourse of Islam is vast. It's vast. The religion is a universal religion. There's not an age of man from the beginning of time to the end of time save that the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam applies to those people in that time, in that age, in that place, in that space. But here what we're speaking about is bringing the religion from its vastness and its universal reality to that which is applicable to each and every single one of us inside of our lives in this age, in this day of ours, in this time, in this blessed month, in this blessed day, in this blessed gathering. How does the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak directly to my heart? Because unless it speaks directly to your heart, then you can never be of those who's transformed by the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So we should study the transformer sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we should study the first generation of those who were transformed from an age where there was no such thing as good and evil. Many of us, we lose sight of the age of Jahiliyyah, the age that preceded the manifestation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was no standard of ethic. There was no scale upon which people were to be judged inside of that age. It's an age of fatra. لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ fatra. The Prophet ﷺ in the Musnad of Ahmed says, everything has a period of cessation, a period of stagnation. And when there's a stagnation of prophecy, the scales upon which human beings are ordinarily judged is removed. And that is one of the secrets why those people who come forth from that age, the Sahaba Kiram, they are unadulterated beauty, unadulterated good. They don't have a stain of evil upon them. Radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu wa ardah spoke about the Messenger of Allah. In the Sunan of Imam Tirmidhi, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam going forth from his house. At a time that he made mention of that nobody exited their house. It's what in English we call an ungodly hour, an ungodly hour. People don't exit their house, save the shayateen, demons, from amongst jinn, from amongst sprites, and from amongst man. There goes the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, closely followed by his khadim, closely followed by his great servant, Sayyidina Anas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, one of the most profound people. Because he teaches us, Sayyidina Anas, one of the things that we take from Sayyidina Anas, يعني كل مسمى له نصيب من اسمه. Everybody gets a portion of their name. Sayyidina Anas is the one who has intimacy. His name means intimacy. And on the basis of the one who he had intimacy with, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's Ibn Malik. He's the son of a king, radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. His intimacy with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, again, it's one of those themes that la budda minhu, that the people of the day and a half have to become more familiar with. That our fate, our individual fate, our fate, our communal fate rests upon the intimacy that we have with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Kad, there are those type of companions that if you were to see the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you would ordinarily see those companions beside the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were those who surrounded the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi and entrained with his reality. Anas is from amongst them. When he follows the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi into the streets of Madinatul Munawwara, lo and behold, who appears? Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq, radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. Abu Bakr appears, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inquires to Abu Bakr, ma ja'a bika ya Aba Bakr? And what is it that brought you out, ya Aba Bakr, at this type of hour in the midst of the night? Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda wants to teach. He's the great teacher. In Jahiliyyah, he was known as the Shaykh. In Islam, whilst the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is alive, he's known as the Shaykh radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. What does Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wa arda say, teaching each and every single one of us? He says radiallahu ta'ala anhu, kharajtu min bayti, that I exited my house, kay anzur ila wajhi rasulillah, just to gaze at the face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And at this point we pause and we reflect. Since when have we ever inside of our heart the type of yearning to gaze upon the blessed face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam? Because if they don't teach us the great cosmic theology, aqidah, of the people of Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the likes of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, famen, then who will teach us that type of reality? And when? And the type of yearning that Sayyidina Asma bint Umays, radiallahu ta'ala anha wa ardaha, the blessed wife of Sayyidina Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, would say that Abu Bakr in the midst of the night would be crying, screaming, wa shawqah li Rasulillah, wa shawqah li Rasulillah, calling out, yearning out for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the average night of Abu Bakr. And they say that the only thing that could settle Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda was when the great woman Sayyidina Asma would tell him that you're of those who gave victory to the Messenger of Allah, that your relationship with the Messenger of Allah is sealed, And he is pleased with you because you are pleased with him. He said that's the only thing that would stop the yearning, the crying of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. What type of man is he who in the midst of his house is yearning for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? A type of feeling that forces him out of his house at a quote unquote ungodly hour. But every hour of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is godly, is holy, is lordly. And he goes out of his house radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. But look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yata'amal ma'ah. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with the greatest Siddiq al-Akbar. That when he walks out of his house, what does he see? The face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama. The sha'n, the affair is sha'n al-mahabba. It's an affair of love. And our ulama radiallahu ta'ala anhum wardahum, they say love is imbued in the heart of a human being based upon husn wal ihsan. Beauty, external beauty, wal ihsan, internal beauty. Two things that are needed in order to what? To procure, to engender, to imbue love inside of the heart of a human being. The face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam is absolute perfect beauty, if we can use such a term. Because the reality of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inwardly and outwardly, لا يعرفني إلا الله. Only Allah ta'ala knows me. He said sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. You know, some of the ulama radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum, they say when you speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being characterized by absolute perfection, khata, you're erroneous, it's wrong. Allah is not characterized by absolute perfection. Why? Because your definition of perfection is your definition of perfection. Limited. Allah Ta'ala is absolved from perfection. Absolved, subhanahu wa ta'ala. La ta'rifu. You don't know Allah Jalla Jalala wa ta'ala ta'azamatu. Likewise, you don't know the Messenger of Allah unless you are Allah. Hakada. That's the equation. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, and what is it that he yearns for to gaze upon the face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Why does the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam and seeing that face become a prerequisite to enter into paradise? The lack of seeing the face becomes the prerequisite for entering into hell. Waylun lima la yarani yawm al-qiyamah. He said, woe to the one who does not see me on the day of judgment. See my face. My face, my face. What is the face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as we sit? Because many of us, when we hear Umar ask, how many of us read the Quran on a daily basis? Okay, we don't read it on a daily basis. We don't read it every two, not every three, not every week, not every month, for matter. Then when do we read the Quran? The sign that we don't read the Quran, that there's no yearning attachment to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran. Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum warda, that their yearning was for the manifest Quran. The Quran imbued the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His form, husn, what was it described as? Waraq al-mushaf. He said, to gaze into the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's as if you're gazing into a piece of the mushaf, the Quran in and of itself. You gaze into his face, you see Fatiha al-Kitab. You gaze into his face, you see Baqarah. You gaze into his face, you see Ali Imran. You gaze into his face, you see Surah An-Nisa. You gaze into his face, then what you see? Why doesn't the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam in al-Asrar, why doesn't he gather the entire Quran inside of a book, a mushaf in his time? Because he was the mushaf sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. It is gathered in him. You want to read the Quran? Read him. Gaze at him, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Hakada the Sahaba. This what distinguished a great generation. Yani the yearning, the desire just to see the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. What would it be like to gaze upon the blessed hair of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That great black curly hair that he had, well groomed, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Center part that used to touch his shoulders, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Imam Abdul Hayy, Muhammad Abdul Hayy al-Kattani, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said every single prophet that has ever been sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is but a strand of the hair of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Azeem shan sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allah calls him azeem, azeem. His reality is azeem. Wa kana fadlullah alaykum azeem. That the grace of Allah ta'ala upon you, ya Muhammad, is azeem. Innaka ala khulqin azeem. You have great character. Your character is azim, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. And we see one of the most important terms that the companions use to describe the blessed face, the blessed figure, physique of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that he was azim, azim, azim. Great, tremendous, sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. Yani, haqiq. Which one of us has yearned to see his hair? Yearned. Which one of us, if you see a characteristic inside of a human being, a character trait that they share with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam, it allows us to fall in love with that type of person, huh? Somebody who shares the same hair as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Somebody who shares the same complexion as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Somebody who shares the same arched eyebrows as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that seemed to join, but they did not join. Somebody who shares the same long, long eyelashes of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Someone that shared the great eyes, the wide eyes of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that was somewhat oriental in nature. Someone who shared the same adaj al-aynain. The hur al-ayn are defined by the eyes of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hur al-ayn, those paradisial maidens, defined by the eyes of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. Somebody who shares the same aquilinity in terms of his nose as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Somebody who shares the same mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-fem, that his mouth was wide and vast sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. When he spoke, that light would emanate from his mouth. That Sayyidina Hind ibn Abi Hala said that when he spoke, it was like arrayed pearls sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. That his cheeks were smooth and somewhat low sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. That his face was extremely round. Sayyidina al-Barra radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda says was the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When asked, was it like a sword or was it like the moon, he said it was like the moon in its roundness, in its beauty, in its splendor sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. What face have we yearned for? What face do we see? Imam Suyuti, Abdul Rahman Suyuti, rahimahullahu ta'ala. This is a random dream of Suyuti, who you can tell you about the fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him, Suyuti. How many times did Imam Suyuti see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inside of the dream state? And how many times have we? And what heart sees the messenger? How many times did Imam Suyuti see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the wake state? He told us about his own reality, radiallahu anhu warda. Which one of us seen him in the wake state? Suyuti is a millennium after, one day after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet he sees him finniyam wa yaqava. Why? The heart that attaches to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahih wa sallam. Hahu Abu Bakr, ma kharajtu illa an anzur ila wajhi Rasulillah. I only came out to see the blessed face of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Look at Sayyidina whom? Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu ta'ala anhu wardan. When he stands in front of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the hadith is Sahih Muslim, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam daraba, the Prophet strikes the heart of Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b. Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b, يعني تفاوت الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم وارضاهم. Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b, he says, كأني أنظر إلى الله. Now when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam strikes my chest, it's as if I am gazing at Allah, Allah. That's what Sayyidina Ubay in Sahih Muslim رضي الله تعالى عنه وارضاه informs each and every single one of us. What type of heart? What type of hand? Huh? We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for profundity of connection. And if you see the face, that you have no option whatsoever save to say, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Hakadha usallim ala Rasulillah. I want to give salams to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Despite yourself, despite the nature of your creation, if you see the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, satusallim alayhi hatman. Despite yourself. Look at that Sayyidina Halima Sa'diya. She said, never did we pass by a tree or rocks inside of the badia, the deserts of Banu Sa'd, say that they would utter, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Peace be upon you, O Messenger of Allah. Hadith of Sayyidina Halima Sa'diya. Sahih Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Inni la'arifu al-ahjar. Verily I know stones, kana tusallim alayya qabla an ub'ath. That they used to give me salams before I was even a prophet. As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Hakadha, the nature of the world, how it connects to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how it yearns to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Abu Bakr, mashallah, tabarakallah. That reality is from the realities of the tradition of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ma sabaqakum Abu Bakr. That Abu Bakr never got ahead of the rest of you bi kathratu salah, with a lot of prayer, wa bi kathratu siyam, and a lot of fasting. No, that's not the sirr of Abu Bakr. Despite the fact that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda, the entire night you would find him in prayer. Despite the fact that Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda would fast tawil, saying Abu Bakr would eat every 1 7 days, 1 every 7 days. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq would eat radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. Despite this, the Hajj and all of the great acts that he has radiallahu anhu, ما سبقكم بهذا. That this is not the reason that he went ahead. ولكن شيء وقر الله في قلب أبي بكر. But it was something that Allah thrust into the heart of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. What is that? Mahabbat al-Nabi. The love of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, from amongst other realities. The love of the Messenger of Allah that he had. That arwah junud al-mujannada, souls are arrayed soldiers. Mumalabith, that he did not remain illa ja' Umar, say that Umar ibn Khattab appears. And when Umar comes, ما جاء بك يا عمر بن الخطاب? Why are you here, يا عمر? Umar says, انظر إلى وجه رسول الله. I just want to see the face of the Messenger of Allah. وأسلم على رسول الله. And to stretch forth my hand upon the Messenger of Allah and say, السلام عليك يا رسول الله. Shan of the Sahaba, رضي الله تعالى عنهم وأرضاهم. Those who gazed upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam's form alone, they would fall in love with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To the point that you have traditions of Madinatul Munawwara, which is the epitome of haya, the epitome of modesty and shyness and bashfulness inside of the city. And more profoundly found inside of the women, inside of Madinatul Munawwara, says that when they would gaze upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as in one example, a woman could come right in front of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say, "I want to marry you." Yani, I want to marry you to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, what is it that would force a woman who is drowsed, embraced, enveloped in shyness and bashfulness, to come in front of the Malak? This wasn't in private, in front of the Rijal of the Sahaba, and say, "I want to marry you." Okay, father. No, the woman comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam whilst he's eating and say, feed me to the Messenger of Allah. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me kind of yurud the sa'il. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would never ever turn away somebody who asked. The hadith of Sayyidina Jabir, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ma nataqa la qat. He never ever said no, ever, 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 sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Feed me, she says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet goes to feed the poor woman. She goes, no, from what's inside of your mouth? I want the food from your mouth, she says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said, look at this woman, the woman who approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Note the context of bashfulness and shyness of the companions, the inhabitants of Medina. They said that this woman, but in that context, she was the most forward of all of the women in Medina to Munawwara. Forward. If there's a time to be forward, it's in front of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if I was him, I'd do the same thing. Yani khalas. Be forward in front of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because look where they get you. The Prophet takes the food from his mouth and he places it inside of her mouth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said when the food from the mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took root inside of her stomach, she was garbed by Allah Ta'ala in the cloak of modesty. That nobody in Medina was more modest than her. Transformed. Just for a luqma, just for a piece of the food of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, intermingled with his blessed saliva. That's the maqsood. Transformation through engaging the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to, because when we speak about virtues, one of the themes here in virtues that we're trying to present, inshallah ta'ala, is the virtue of loving the Prophet himself sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wasallam. You can see people in the hadith in al-Bukhari, the hadith in Muslim, hadith of Sayyidina Anas, the great khadim of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, giving a khutbah, and then they attend at the khutbah. And then a man in the midst of the khutbah, يعني, he says, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, Meta Sa'a, when is the hour? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam ignored him, khalas, continued to speak. At the end of the khutbah, the Prophet turns and says, Ain't a Sa'il. Where's the one who asked the question? Ha ana ya Rasulullah. It's me, O Messenger of Allah. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked him, but through him asks each and every single one of us, Mada a'dadta laha? What have you prepared for it? It's not when it is, It's what have you prepared for the moment? Because the moment's going to come, whether the kubra, the collapse of the entire universe, or the sughra, your own mortality, your death. It's going to come, the moment. ماذا أعددت لها? Look at the mafhum of the hadith. The man says to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, I haven't prepared a lot of prayer. But he's of those who prayed, hatman, no doubt. I haven't prepared a lot of fasting, but he's of those who fasted, no doubt. But there's one thing I do know, that I am certain of, أحب الله ورسوله. I love Allah and His Messenger. That's it. What does the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? أنت مع من أحببت. You are with the one whom you love. You are with the one whom you love. يعني for some of us, maybe, Allahu A'lam, maybe that's Marilyn Monroe. And you're with the one whom you love after all. And maybe. And who is it that we really love? And it really love? And sign of whom you love, who do you see when you dream? Who? Who? The sign of the one whom you love. Yeah, and who is it? Is in your heart that you yearn to be with, yearn to see, yearn to intermingle with, yearn for that one to place food inside of your mouth. Yearn to be in union. Who? Men, men, men. Who? The answer to that question is, yani our fate is determined by the answer to that question. Anta ma man ahbabt. Look at the boldness of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik. Anas ibn Malik in the version of Sahih Muslim, he says, yani, we, the companions, we had never heard any words that were more sweeter to us than those words of the Messenger of Allah. A person is with the one who he loves. Because you could have said in one tradition, he said, you are with the one whom you love. No division. Am, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-mar ma'a man ahab. A human being is with the one whom he loves. Then look at the boldness further of Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu warla. Yani, he says it was the sweetest thing we ever heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takallama an Allah, spoke about Allah ta'ala, takallama an al-malakut, spoke about the unseen realm. Spoke in the hadith of Hudhayfa and Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab of everything from the beginning of time till Ahlul Jannah and to Jannah, Ahlul Nar and to Nar. But the most sweetest thing they ever heard, Al-Mar, Ma'aman, Ahab, a human being is with the one whom he loves. And just in case you think that he was in love with the Marilyn Monroe of his time, maybe, he said, Ana Uhib Rasulullah. I love the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I said, Wa Ana Uhib Aba Bakr. And I love Abu Bakr. Wa ana uhib Umar. And I love Umar. And I have good hope I will be with them even though my deeds are not like them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for tawfiq and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala garbs each and every single one of us with the cloak of virtue. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sallam.